Stephanie Menendez. All right, Ms. Menendez, if you can raise your right hand, do you swear affirm that the testimony you're about to present before this court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? So, you got it.
I do.
Please be seated. If you will, can you state your full name and spell your last name, please?
My name is Stephanie Menendez, M-E-N-E-N-D-E-Z.
And Ms. Menendez, where do you work?
I am employed at the Georgia Bureau of Investigation as a forensic chemist.
And how long have you worked for the firm?
I have worked there since August 2012.
And since 2012, what is it that you actually do at the crime lab? What does a forensic chemist do?
At the crime lab, I analyze samples brought to the agency by law enforcement agencies for the presence or absence of a controlled substance.
If I can get you just to move a little closer, thank you. What sort of educational background do you have that allows you to do what you do?
I graduated from the Georgia Institute of Technology with a bachelor's in science and chemistry.
All right. And do you belong to any professional organizations?
I am part of CLIC.
And what is CLIC?
CLIC is Clandestine Laboratory Investigating Chemist.
And have you ever taught others in the field of forensic chemistry, either formally or informally?
Yes, I have.
And tell the jury about those occasions.
I have taught another chemist on how to perform a peer review.
Have you ever testified as an expert before?
Yes, I have.
In what field?
In forensic chemistry.
All right. And how many times have you testified as an expert?
Approximately 10 times.
And what jurisdictions or courts have you appeared before?
I have appeared in Catoosa County, in Gwinnett County, and DeKalb County.
Your Honor, at this time, we would like to tender Ms. Menendez as an expert in the field of forensic chemistry.
Any objection? Your Honor, I'm looking at the state expert wouldn't listen. I don't see Ms. Melendez, unless they got something new. I'm looking at the expert witness list, sir, and I didn't have that on them unless they got something. She be on your new witness list, sir.
Your Honor, can we take this matter up outside, please? Your Honor, Ms. Menendez was involved in the identification of the substances found in the car. Initially, Ms. Amber Sloan is the one that did the original test for the cocaine. She was the one that did the peer review. There are several cases on point that when a crime lab forensic chemist or other related scientists is unable to appear, either they have left the state, they have quit their position, or for whatever reason, the individual that did the peer review is able to testify in their behalf. discuss is as long as they're just not a mere conduit of hearsay. And in this case, I would proffer to the court. I would anticipate Ms. Menendez in saying that she reviewed all the analyst data and that she looked at that data and arrived at an independent conclusion of Ms. Sloan, which actually agrees with Ms. Sloan's testing. In addition to that, under OCGA 17-6-8, the courts discussed that the trial court has discretion with regard to allowing a witness that wasn't on the state's witness list. And some of the things that the courts have discussed in these cases is regarding whether the defendant is somehow surprised by the witness. I would submit to the court that she's going to testify to a lab report that they received. Therefore, there's really no surprise as to the subject matter of her testimony. Furthermore, if the defendant needs to interview the witness, certainly the court has the discretion to do that. But what the case is saying is that unless there's some bad faith and unless the state is trying to hide specific evidence, the court is at the discretion to allow a witness to testify, even though it didn't appear or the witness didn't appear on the witness list. I do have some case sites if you like.
Your Honor, why is she isn't available? Why didn't they let me know way before this? You know, 17-16-1, 17-16-4, that you're supposed to be on the witness list? And
we'll ask that. What else, if anything else?
I just have a problem with them bringing people ain't even on the witness list and I ain't on anybody. You know, they're supposed to be prepared. You know, they don't want me to use certain evidence, but they're going to come in here and use a witness that ain't even on their witness list. Could they tell us why she's not here? Was she dismissed? Did she, you know, why was she just taking?
I understand the question. I will say that.
I may have to ask the witness. I'm not sure why Amber Sloan isn't here. I know she doesn't work there anymore, but I don't know the circumstances.
What caused you to file? You filed an additional discovery response last Friday.
Yes, sir.
Lister, what caused you to do that?
Because we discovered that in May of this year, she tested the Xanax and Alprazolam. We had no idea that she had done that.
This witness.
Correct. But also this witness peer-reviewed Ms. Amber Sloan's drug test for the cocaine. Now we did become aware of that about a week ago.
So is Amber Sloan going to testify?
No, Your Honor.
And when did you learn of this witness then?
I mean, if you're asking me personally, it's been within the past week. I can't speak for the entire office.
Well, I mean, I think that's relevant.
I agree.
We need to find out when you learn.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
been about 3 weeks.
And this was filed on Friday?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What else? And you want to talk to me about the delay in doing that?
I mean, it's just an oversight on the state's end. Yeah. It was not bad faith. We're not trying to hide anything. It's just an oversight. There's a lot of evidence, a lot of witnesses, and I'm not making excuses. I'm just being honest with you.
So what is your suggestion as a remedy?
Well, the remedies that the case law discusses, that if the defense feels like they're at somehow some sort of disadvantage, then we wait on calling the witness and give the defendant an opportunity to interview the witness if she says anything different from Ms. Amber Sloan. But typically, the courts don't simply exclude witnesses. If bad faith is involved, if there isn't some sort of underhandedness or trying to disclose certain facts from coming out, that's not what is occurring in this case.
Was there anything else?
Amber Sloan, sir?
It's too loud.
Oh.
You don't need to do that. I can hear you just fine.
Miss Amber Sloan.
Ms. Herbert, if you'll have a seat, please. Thank you.
We don't know why she was dismissed. It could have, I don't know why, you know, it's new to me. Yeah, I just want it done the right way at the end of the day. I mean, if I got to follow the rules, they didn't, that for my discovery, they were telling me I got to have it in, I couldn't use it. I feel like they telling me to follow the simple discovery, they got to follow it too. So, in that regard, I would object to her testifying to something that we can't cross-examine. And they know better than me. Case been going on 4.5 years, so this really ain't no excuse for them not knowing.
The report that she's going to testify about, was that reported on last Friday as well?
One of the reports, the Alprazolam, the other report was given months ago. Amber Sloan.
Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to ask you to step down. I'm going to suggest, I see Mr. Hood's investigator is here. Perhaps he can speak with her. And I don't know if we'll call her back today or what, but
yes, sir.
They'll be able to do
yes,
that
sir.
During the day.
Yes, sir.
Today. All right. You can step down.
Ms. Horton, if you will, raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to present before this court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? So you got it.
Yes, I do.
Please be seated. Ms. Horton, if you would, please state your full name and spell your last name for the court.
My full name is Mary Elizabeth Horton. My last name is spelled H-O-R-T-O-N.
And Ms.
I am retired from the Georgia Bureau of Investigations Division of Forensic Sciences, that's commonly known as the State Crime Lab. I worked in the Trace Evidence Section as a microanalyst.
And how many years did you work for the GBI as a forensic analyst?
I worked for the GBI a total of 36 years. I worked approximately 17 and a half years as a microanalyst.
And basically, what is a microanalyst, and what do you do?
As a microanalyst, I was asked to typically look at items to see if there could have been a transfer of materials between the two items, or in the case of fracture matches, to determine if two items that were cut, torn, or somehow separated had at one time been one item. Typically, my area of expertise was paints and polymers, and so when I was looking for materials, that was what I was looking for, was paints and plastics.
All right. And can you briefly describe your educational background that allows you to do what you do?
I have a Bachelor of Science degree in chemistry from Georgia State University. I completed an approximately 19-month-long training program at GBI on the analysis of paints and polymers. Also completed an approximately 3-month-long training program on the analysis of fracture matches. I attended several different courses through the FBI and other universities that were workshops that were offered through universities during my career.
And ma'am, do you hold any certifications?
I am a fellow with the American Board of Criminalistics. My specialty area is paints and polymers.
And have you ever taught anyone else, either formally or informally, in the field of forensic analysis or as a microanalyst?
As a microanalyst, I was asked to train at least two people in the analysis of paints and polymers.
And have you ever testified before as an expert?
Yes, I have.
In what field?
I have offered testimony in paints and polymers, fracture matches, and also area called general materials.
And do you recall approximately how many times you testified as an expert?
This number is really off the top of my head, but I think it was somewhere between 30 and 35 times.
And do you recall what jurisdictions or courts you have appeared before and testified as an expert?
I testified for probation revocation hearings. I also testified in superior courts in the state of Georgia at various counties throughout the state of Georgia, and I believe I probably testified in probate court. I'm not absolutely sure about that.
Your Honor, at this time we would tender Ms. Horton as an expert in the field as a microanalyst.
Any objection?
No, sir, Your Honor.
Now, you've already alluded to this idea of looking at items and determining fracture matches. Can you sort of describe the process that you go through when you receive items and you're trying to determine if there is a fracture match?
Fracture matches performed on items in which a single item, a complete item object, at one time had been either cut, torn, or somehow separated. Then I would be asked to look at them and see if I could determine if they were at one time one and a single piece. So basically, after opening the package, I would look at the items and just basically see, do they look alike? You know, am I looking at duct tape, question duct tape to non-duct tape? Am I looking at a piece of plastic from a cup to a cup that's missing material? Basically, you are looking to make sure first that the two items that you're going to look at appear to be the same. When you look at duct tape, a lot of people say duct tape is duct tape. Well, you look at it to make sure that the plastic backing on the duct tape is the same color. And then you look at the adhesive to see if the adhesive is the same color. And then you can look at things like the screen fabric to see if it is constructed in the
during this process of determining whether there's a fracture match, do you utilize any type of instruments?
The first basic thing that you use is your eyes to be sure that things do look alike. Then if you do need to get down with a microscopic level and begin to look at detail that is present on the microscopic level, then you might use various types of microscopes for fracture matches typically.
And are the procedures you just described, are they generally accepted by the scientific community?
Yes, they are.
And are these procedures reliable and reproducible?
Yes, they are.
And are these procedures based on valid scientific theory?
Yes, they are.
Now, back on April 18, 2011, did the crime lab receive evidence in regard to duct tape that was recovered from a Cadillac?
My records indicate that on March 28, there was evidence received in the laboratory that was duct tape.
Okay. And with regard to your notes, were they items 13 and 14?
They were entered in the laboratory with a unique laboratory case number, and then each item was given its own unique item number, 13 and 14, yes.
All right. With regard to item 14, what was that item?
Item 14 is a sealed package containing the sections of duct tape identified as from the trunk of a Cadillac.
And item 13?
The laboratory's item 13, it was a sealed package containing duct tape identified as from the right front floorboard of a Cadillac.
Right. Now, with regard to the sections of duct tape, is it important that you kind of stretch out the duct tape and make sure and ensure that they don't fold on themselves and make it more difficult for testing?
Typically, what you receive is you typically receive one item will be a roll of duct tape, and hopefully that is still a completely intact or a partially used roll. I should say totally intact, but a partially used roll. And then often the other duct tape, if it has been used at all, it may be folded back upon itself. So you do have to very carefully try not to stretch it, but you very carefully try to open up the duct tape so that you can expose any ends that have been either cut, torn, or somehow separated.
And once that process occurs, if you ever use, say, a pizza box in order to store those pieces?
Typically because these items will usually go to another section for other analyses to be performed. Once the process of taking the duct tape apart from itself, then yes, we do usually mount it on something like a cardboard box or it may actually go on a piece of plastic, an open plastic bag or something like that, and then be put into a cardboard box for stability.
Thank you. Your Honor, at this time I'd like to show Ms. Horton what's already been tendered and states exhibits 86 and 87. Starting with State's Exhibit 86, do you recognize that to crime?
This item is identified with not only the Division of Forensic Sciences barcode label, it's also, I have written the case number and also the item number, and these are my initials on here, and this, the there's also a seal that I made that bears my initials also.
And can you look inside the bag and just see if that's the item you would call? Using in your testing process?
Yes, this is the roll of partial duct tape that I examined for this in this instance.
And when State's Exhibit 87, do you recognize that particular item?
time would have placed the items of duct tape into after I separated them. Again, it has the Division of Forensic Sciences barcode label with our case number. I've written the case number, the item number, and there are my initials. And I also sealed the package once I put everything inside of it.
And was there, when you received these packages, were there any signs of damage or tampering?
No, there was not.
Okay. And looking at State Exhibit 87, do you recognize the items?
These are the items of duct tape that I analyzed.
Now, when you received these items, what specific test was requested of you?
I was asked to perform a fracture match comparison between the roll of duct tape and the sections of duct tape.
And did you perform the process that you've already described on these two pieces of evidence?
Yes, I did.
And based on the procedures you performed, your education, your experience, and your expert opinion, did you form an opinion as to whether there was a fracture match?
Yes, I did.
And what was that opinion?
After examination and comparison of the torn ends of duct tape sections with the torn end of the duct tape roll, I was not able to find any association by fracture comparison.
Now, did you do any additional testing of these items?
I did not do any additional testing, no.
Did you make a suggestion in your official report that an additional test could be performed?
I did make a note that these items are similar in appearance and are suitable for a compositional comparison that could be performed at a later date.
And what is a compositional comparison?
A compositional comparison looks at the composition of the duct tape. It looks at the backing to see what the what type of backing is on, is the plastic backing is, and then the adhesive to see what kind of adhesive it is. And then it also looks at the screw fabric, which can be composed of various fabrics and fibers.
I'd like to show you what's been marked in State's Exhibit 735. No, Your Honor, and those were marked on exhibits for the preceding witness, so we'll have to come back to those. Ms. Horton, do you recognize State's Exhibit 735?
This is a copy of my report on the fracture match.
And does it fairly and accurately present the testing and the procedure you use as well as your conclusions for the fracture match?
Yes, it does.
Your Honor, State moves to enter State's Exhibit 735.
Any objection?
No, sir. Your Honor, submitted.
One moment. Let me just ask you a couple of questions to sort of clarify what you mean by a fracture match. When you say there is no fracture,
is there an objection?
Yes, sir, Your Honor.
I would ask that if they're going to admit this, that it don't go out with the jury because that will violate the continuing testimony. It's like a continuing testimony.
We'll type that up.
Okay.
And I'll see you. When you indicated to the jury that there was not a fracture match, are you saying that the pieces that you examined did not come from the roll you examined? Is that what you're indicating?
Maybe I didn't fully explain. When you perform a fracture match and you do have a positive fracture match, you are able to say that this item, that and a duct tape were at one time the same lot.
But you are not saying that those pieces of tape did not come from that duct tape. You're just saying the way they're torn or the way they were removed, there's no specific match to the two items. Is that correct?
That is correct. I was not able to find an association of the fracture or the torn ends. If the items had not been similar in all of those areas that I talked about, the color of the backing, the color of the adhesive, the construction of the spring fabric that is in between the adhesive and the backing, if all of those had not been alike, then I would not have proceeded to look at the torn ends, because if the adhesive on one piece had been gray and the other adhesive had been off-white, then there would have been no reason to look for a fracture match, because they were totally not the same thing. But in this instance, because everything looked to be the same, then I did look for the fractured ends to see if I could find a correspondence between those fractured ends, and that is what I was not able to find, was the correspondence.
All right. Thank you.
Can I have an excuse, Your Honor?
Any objections?
No, sir.
No, Your Honor.
Thank you, sir.
Call your next witness.
Your Honor, the state calls Kristen Webb.
Kristen Webb.
Good afternoon, Ms. Webb. If you will, please raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to present before this court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Help you God.
I do.
Please be seated. If you will, could you state your full name and spell your last name for the court?
Yes, my name is Kristen Webb, W-E-B-B.
And Ms. Webb, where do you work?
I'm employed by the Georgia Bureau of Investigations, Division
And what is it that you do with the GBI forensic, the Department of Forensic Sciences?
Yes, I'm a scientist in the trace evidence section there.
Okay. And you also go by the term a microanalyst?
Yes, the scientists in the trace evidence section are often referred to as microanalysts.
All right. And do you have certain specialties or certain functions that you perform separate and apart from, say, other employees?
Yes, there's several different types of evidence that we analyze in the trace evidence section. Of those types, I perform exams in gunshot residue analysis, glass comparisons, paints, plastic, polymers.
I have an objection. I'm looking at a photo. I don't have the report. The report she testified to, I've got reports on service experts. So I would like to have a report. If, you know, if she's going to testify something, I want you to
this one.
Yes.
Was a report forwarded?
Yes. I mean, I can make a copy.
Yeah, I keep all of my.
Well, I can't say where what happened.
Yeah, exactly. But I just know.
You're asking for a copy of the report. We'll get you a copy.
Yeah, I like that very much. So I see.
I continue. Now, can you briefly describe your educational background that allows you to do what you do?
Yes, I earned a Bachelor of Science in Chemistry as well as a Bachelor of Arts in Criminal Justice from the University of Georgia prior to being employed by the GBI Crime Lab. Upon entering the trace evidence section at the GBI Crime Lab, for each of the types of evidence that I do perform analyses on, I underwent a specific training program for that evidence type.
And I don't know if I asked you this, how long have you been doing this sort of thing?
I've been with the GBI Crime Lab for about 8 years now, specifically in the trace evidence section for almost 7 years.
And did you work anywhere else prior to the GBI Crime Lab?
Well, within the GBI Crime Lab, I did work in the morgue as a medical examiner investigator. That was my first job right out of college, and then I transferred to the trace evidence section.
And do you hold any certifications?
Yes, sir, I do. I am certified by the American Board of Criminalistics, specifically in reference to trace evidence, paints, and polymers.
And have you had any specialized training with regard to oppositional comparisons?
Yes, many of the types of evidence that I look at are compositional comparisons. For instance, paints, polymers, glass, tape is a subset of plastics. Those are all compositional exams. So in addition to going through the training at the GBI Crime Lab, I have attended classes throughout the nation in reference to those materials.
Okay. And can you just briefly describe to the jury what do you mean by compositional comparisons?
A compositional comparison is typically what we're given is a question sample and a sample of known origin. What you're going to do is you're going to look at the composition, what makes up those products that would involve looking at the physical properties, the chemical properties down to the molecular level. You're going to do a comparison to see if you see any differences between those two items to see if you can say, are these items dissimilar, meaning the question source did not come from the known item, or are all the properties alike, and then you can make a conclusion as to the association of those two types.
Thank you. Now, do you belong to any professional organizations?
Yes, I belong to SAFS, which stands for the Southern Association of Forensic Scientists. I also belong to ASTI, which stands for the American Society of Trace Evidence Examiners.
Have you ever taught other people in the field being a microanalyst, whether formally or informally?
Yes, I did have the opportunity to train one of our analysts in the area of gunshot residue analysis.
Now, have you ever testified as an expert before?
Yes, sir, I have.
And in what field?
I have testified predominantly for gunshot primer residue analysis, but also for paints and fracture materials.
And about how many times have you been qualified as an expert?
about 30 times.
And do you recall what jurisdictions or courts you have testified before?
Yes, various ones across the state of Georgia. Clark County included, Fulton, DeKalb, Cherokee, Chatham. I couldn't list them all for you, but numerous ones throughout the state.
Thank you. Your Honor, at this time, we would like to tender Ms. Kristen Webb as an expert in the field as a micro analyst.
Any objection?
No, sir. Your Honor,
the witness should be allowed to testify as an expert in the field of micro analyst.
Thank you, Your Honor. Now, can you briefly describe to the jury when you're trying to determine the compositional comparison of, say, two items, what sort of process or procedure do you go through in trying to make that determination?
It's actually going to vary depending on the type of evidence that I'm looking at, but specifically in regards to tape comparisons. I'm always going to begin with the physical characteristics of the tape. That's where you're going to see the most variation right off the bat. You can just imagine there's various different types of tape, for instance, duct tape, electrical tape, packaging tapes. Those are obviously distinguishable from each other based on color and even just the way that the tape feels. If you then take it to just looking at duct tapes, you're going to see a lot of variation in duct tapes based on the color of the backing, the thickness of the backing, the way it looks. The next layer of the tape is what we call a scrim fabric. You probably noticed when you tried to tear duct tape, it doesn't tear very easily because it has that weave pattern of fibers in it. We're going to look at those characteristics. And then finally, we're also going to look at the adhesive material. Adhesives are going to vary greatly between different types of duct tape. How sticky are they? How hard was it for you to pull that tape off? Those characteristics that you noticed, we're able to look at on the chemical, microscopical, and just physical level and make determinations based on that.
And when you're doing the chemical analysis, do you use any particular instruments to assist you with that?
Yes. Initially, when we're looking at the physical properties, we're going to use a variety of light microscopes that are just going to help us visualize the evidence at a higher magnification. Then, once we move on from looking at the physical properties, and we're going to take it to the next level and look at the chemical properties, we're going to use several different types of instrumentation that allow us to look at different parts of the evidence. One of those would be what is called an FTIR. That stands for Fourier Transform Infrared Microspectroscopy. What that's going to do is it allows us to shine infrared light on the sample. And based on how a sample absorbs that light, we're able to determine what type of sample it is. So I'm able to tell you what type of backing material is on the tape. I'm able to tell you what type of adhesive. Is it a rubber-based? Is it more of a synthetic-based adhesive? Things like that are properties that we're able to examine. In addition, we're going to use several different instruments to determine the elemental composition of the samples. So that would mean, what type of elements do I actually see in the backing and in the adhesive? Do I see strontium? Do I see lead? Picture your periodic table. I'm looking for those elements to see what's present in them. And ultimately, what we're doing in the compositional comparison is I'm looking at a known source of tape and a question source, and I'm looking at those properties and I'm trying to see, is there any differences between the two?
And these procedures that you just described to the jury, are these procedures generally accepted in the scientific community?
Yes, they are.
And are these procedures reliable and reproducible?
Yes, sir.
And are these procedures based on valid scientific theory?
Yes, they are.
Now, if you will, if I can show the witness State's Exhibit 86 and 87. Do you have gloves up there with you?
Yes, sir, I do.
I'm going to begin by asking, first of all, do you recognize those items that have already been tendered in evidence? We'll start with the State's Exhibit
sense?
Yes, I do.
And how do you recognize that particular item?
This item of evidence I recognize by our DOFS seal, our barcode, which stands for Division of Forensic Science. It has a unique case number on it, as well as a unique item number that the lab has given to this piece of evidence so that we can track it. And I also recognize, I initialed it when I opened the evidence as well, so I recognize it that way.
Right. Can you pull the item out of that?
Yes.
And is that the item you recall testing for the compositional comparison?
Yes, it is. And I know that because in here on the core, I wrote the case number and added my initials as well.
And do you have any idea where this item came from? Are you given that sort of information when you're doing your testing?
Yes, we're giving submission forms, and also by looking at the evidence packaging, I'm told that this item of evidence came from the right front floorboard of a Cadillac.
Right, thank you. Now, did you receive any items for comparison?
Yes.
Is that State's Exhibit 87?
Yes, that would be State's Exhibit 87.
Can you open that? Well, first of all, how do you recognize State's Exhibit 87?
State's Exhibit 87 has that same DOFS barcode with the same case number. However, it has a different item number. And also, I see my initials from when I opened the evidence.
Would you mind opening the box and taking a look at the items? And are those the items you performed in your comparison?
Yes, sir.
All right. And do you mind just, if you can, sort of explain to the jury?
Yeah, you can see right here, this is the original packaging that the tape came in, and just for ease, it was placed in this box so that the tape could be spread out.
And, thank you. And with regard to these particular items, did you begin with a visual inspection of the two items?
Yes, and you're always going to begin with a visual inspection of the packaging first. In this instance, the packaging had already been seen by several other sections in the lab before I got it. So I was able to compare images in the case file of how the evidence originally came in and look at other analyst notes to make sure that the integrity of the evidence was maintained. So I'm going to examine that and take notes on the outer packaging, and then I'm going to proceed to taking notes on the physical characteristics that I see of the items inside.
Now, I neglected with respect to State's Exhibit 87, do you have any idea where those items came from?
Those items came from, they're identified by the submission form and the evidence packaging as being from the trunk of a Cadillac.
And when you received both of these items, were there any signs that the items had been damaged or tampered with?
No, I could see evidence that it had undergone other exams in the section, though.
Now, after you do your visual examination in your comparison, what step did you take next?
After I did the visual exam, I noted characteristics such as backing color, the width, the thickness. I described the weave of the fabric that's in the duct tape. I looked at the adhesive, the color, the granules inside of the adhesive, and I made note of all those properties. And then once I didn't see any differences between the question tape that was identified as coming from the trunk and the known roll of duct tape that was identified as coming from the floorboard, I then moved on and examined the chemical characteristics and the organic characteristics of some of the instrumentation that I mentioned earlier. Once my exam was complete, I was then able to come to a conclusion concerning these two types of evidence.
Okay, and based on your training, your experience, and your education, what was that opinion?
My opinion in regards to this case was that the physical and chemical characteristics of the backing, the scrim fabric, and the adhesive were alike between the known roll of duct tape and the question pieces of duct tape. Therefore, the question pieces of duct tape either originated from that roll of duct tape or another roll of duct tape with the same distinct properties.
Now, did you record your findings in the testing procedures you went through in an official showing GBI forensic report.
Yes, I did.
I'm showing you what's been marked in State's Exhibit 736. I would ask, do you recognize State's Exhibit 736?
I do.
And what is it?
State's Exhibit 736 is a DOFS official report that has that same case number. It has the items of evidence listed, and on the back it has the signature at the end of it.
And does that official forensic report fairly and accurately represent your testing procedures and your conclusions from that testing?
Yes, I'm looking at a copy of the report that I brought and looking at this one, and they are the same.
Your Honor, at this time, the state moves to tender State's Exhibit 736.
Any objection?
No, sir, Your Honor.
Yes, based on the chain of custody that I see that it did go into the possession of Ms. Horton, and I was able to see an official report released by her.
Okay. I noticed you and her say you can't tell 100% where that particular item come from. Like you said, it was a difference there. What was that difference?
I'm sorry, what was the difference?
Yes, ma'am.
I actually noticed no differences in my exam. However, duct tape is made in a batch. So while these two types of duct tape, or these two items of duct tape, had all the same properties that I was able to examine, I'm not able to say to the exclusion of all other rolls of duct tape. That's not something that this examination can do. I am able to say that the duct tape would have to have the same distinct properties to be like this.
Ma'am, did you say something that you know about, like, gunpowder, anything? Did I hear you say that you were an expert in gunpowder, anything like that, ma'am?
Not gunpowder specifically, gunshot residue, slightly different than gunpowder, but yes, that's one of the types of evidence I look at.
Okay, what is this gunpowder residue? Could you tell us about that?
Gunpowder residue is not something that I do, but I do look at gunshot primer residue. Gunshot primer residue is an exam that we perform. Typically, we look at the hands of subjects, samples that have been taken from the hands, and we analyze those to see if particles from the primer of the ammunition are present.
Yes. Okay, could you tell the jury how would that gunpowder residue get on the clothes?
When a gun is fired, many particles come out of that gun. That's going to be particles from the powder of the ammunition, particles from the cartridge case, particles from the primer. The gun gets so hot and it reaches high pressures that all those particles are forced out, and they do land on the surrounding surfaces where a gun has been fired.
Okay. Now, if you real close up on an item, just say this right here. If I fire the gun, this close, would that gunpowder residue get on this if it is close?
Yes.
So, if you got, the gunpowder residue will be able to indicate how close, how far away somebody already fired a gun or something. Is that correct?
I would like to make a distinction. I don't look at powder residue. I look at primer residue. So looking at powder residue is an exam that the firearm section of our lab does, and they do distance determinations. That's not exactly what I'm looking at.
Okay, but could it have from, residue from gun, if you 1 foot, 2, 3, all the way, and that's why they have the gunpowder residue test, ma'am?
Yes, it's going to depend on a lot of factors, how much gunshot residue, if any, is present. But yes, if you fire a gun, gunshot residue would be produced.
Okay, just if I fire a gun from here to that American flag over there, gunpowder residue won't get on that from here, will it?
Your Honor, I'm going to object at this point. She's not qualified in that type of gunshot residue determination.
Sustained.
You indicated you let me ask you this, if somebody that is involved in a situation like that, but doesn't get apprehended until 7 days later, would that expanse of time affect anyone's ability to determine gunshot residue?
Yes, gunshot residue particles.
Regarding gunshot residue finding, would the fact that someone was not apprehended for several days, could that interfere with your ability to determine that sort of test on a suspect?
Yes, when we look at samples, it's very important for us to know the amount of time between the alleged incident and when the collection occurred, because these particles don't last forever. They begin to fall off even immediately after they've been deposited. So within a window, and it's typically thought to be between 8 and 10 hours, you're no longer going to see gunshot residue on somebody's hands, even if they did fire a weapon. But that's going to depend on the activities of the individual. Did they wash their hands? Did they wipe their hands over their clothing? It's highly variable in what causes that to happen, but yes, it's going to begin to fall off.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's free. Would it fall off clothing?
It would fall off clothing, however, clothing's a little different. It's a fabric. It's a weave. It's not like your hands that are just a flat surface. The weave's going to retain those particles a little longer than hands would.
Okay. So how long would it be on clothing?
I can't give an amount of time to that because it's so variable between different amounts of clothing. So for instance, we don't typically look at clothing items in our section for GSR. It's an exam that we can do that has to have manager approval, and it's because I can't place an incident time on that, because that GSR, gunshot primer residue, could have been there indefinitely on clothing.
Okay, but you would agree that if a person close enough on somebody and got on clothing, it would get on them. Is that correct, ma'am?
It's possible. It's going to be harder to transfer from a weave pattern in the clothing than it would, per se, from hands, but it is